Welcome to another online service from Orono United Church. Whoever you are and wherever you are, thank you for joining us today. We're glad you've been able to make it and to find time to give God some praise. This is our online service for October the 18th. Thank you for joining us. Let's go into worship. This service begins, as it always does, with a responsive call to worship. If you would please respond to my words by saying together the larger print. If we get too comfortable, O God, challenge us to reflect on our lives. If we become too set in our ways, O God, challenge us to try things differently. If we become too obsessed with worldly things, O God, challenge us to seek holiness. As we light our Christ candle today, we celebrate that Jesus Christ is the light of the world. We also light this in dedication to all those who are in lockdown. We ask that you keep each other in your prayers. You are all important to us and to each other. We are a fellowship, even though we are currently apart. Eleanor Fargen was the daughter of a British novelist and the granddaughter of an American actor. Her own books of stories, which were mostly written for children, proved to be immensely popular. But a hymn that she wrote outlived them all in popularity. She was the writer of "Morning Has Broken," and we'll sing it now. We're going to enter into conversation with God through prayer. This is our prayer of approach. Let us say it together. Let us pray. Holy God, we come to you with praise on our lips and songs of joy in our hearts. We come to affirm that good is stronger than evil, that love is stronger than hate, that truth will ultimately win the day. Keep our hearts focused on things that are worthy of praise, and bless us with your peace. Keep our thoughts focused on Christ and his promises to us. Amen. It's good news time again, and this week I have three birthdays to share with you. First of all, congratulations and happy birthday to Norman Tilson. Now, Norm's not in Orono anymore, we trust. We think he should be safely in his new home in Nova Scotia. I haven't heard any updates, but I'm trusting that you've moved in safe and well. Norm and Jane Ann, we wish you every success in your new venture, and we hope your dreams are fulfilled. And happy birthday on Wednesday, Norm. Then on Saturday, there are two celebrations. First of all, Charlene Perrin. It's her birthday on Saturday, and she's been such an inspiration in the years that she's been a member of our congregation. Thank you for all you've done, Charlene, and many, many congratulations and happy returns for your birthday. And the same day, Gentleman Jim. Jim Merriweather. Congratulations, Jim. Happy birthday to you. Again, someone that's worked on our committees, a member of our M&P committee, and a very fine person. Happy birthday to you, Jim. Congratulations. Just a reminder, as always, let me know if you have any good news. It would be wonderful to hear from you so that I can share it with others. Let's fill this world with good news. Please join with me in saying the Lord's Prayer. Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. When Joachim Neander was a student in Bremen, Germany, he was apparently rather riotous. One day, he and a couple of his friends decided to go to church. There was a visiting preacher who was rather famous, and they went there with the intention of making fun of him and picking holes in his sermon. What happened, however, was that Neander was strangely moved by what he heard, and he gave his life to Christ. He didn't live a long life. He died at the age of 30, but many of his hymns have lasted, including this one, Praise to the Lord, the Almighty.
Praise to the Lord, the Almighty, the King of
as we come to our Old Testament scripture. It's again part of the story of Moses. This is the time when Moses was desperate to see the glory of God for himself. This is what happened. We hear it from Exodus 33, beginning at verse 12.
Exodus chapter 33. Moses said to the Lord, "You have been telling me, 'Lead these people.' But you have not let me know whom you will send with me. You have said, 'I know you by name,' and you have found favor with me. If you are pleased with me, teach me your ways, so I may know you and continue to find favor with you. Remember that this nation is your people." The Lord replied, "My presence will go with you, and I will give you rest." Then Moses said to him, "If your presence does not go with us, do not send us up from here. How will anyone know that you are pleased with me and with your people unless you go with us? What else will distinguish me and your people from all the other people on the face of the earth?" And the Lord said to Moses, "I will do the very thing you have asked, because I am pleased with you, and I know you by name." Then Moses said, "Now show me your glory." And the Lord said, "I will cause all my goodness to pass in front of you, and I will proclaim my name, the Lord, in your presence. I will have mercy on whom I will have mercy, and I will have compassion on whom I will have compassion." But, he said, "You cannot see my face, for no one may see me and live." Then the Lord said, "There is a place near me where you may stand on a rock. When my glory passes by, I will put you in a cleft in the rock and cover you with my hand until I have passed by. Then I will remove my hand, and you will see my back, but my face must not be seen."
Our gospel reading today is about one of everybody's favorite subjects, taxes. Or at least it's about a time when the Pharisees and the Herodians tried to trick Jesus by asking him a question about a tax that only non-Roman citizens had to pay. In other words, this was a tax that was inflicted upon the countries that Rome had conquered. Should the Jews pay this tax? Here's how Jesus dealt with that question. We hear it from Matthew's Gospel, the 22nd chapter, reading from verse 15.
Then the Pharisees went out and laid plans to trap him in his words. They sent their disciples to him along with the Herodians. "Teacher," they said, "we know that you are a man of integrity and that you teach the way of God in accordance with the truth. You aren't swayed by others because you pay no attention to who they are. Tell us then, what is your opinion? Is it right to pay the imperial tax to Caesar or not?" But Jesus, knowing their evil intent, said, "You hypocrites, why are you trying to trap me? Show me the coin used for paying the tax." They brought him a denarius, and he asked them, "Whose image is this, and whose inscription?" "Caesar's," they replied. Then he said to them, "So give back to Caesar what is Caesar's, and to God what is God's." When they heard this, they were amazed, so they left him and went away.
How wonderful it would be to be perfect. How great would that feel? Except when you start telling yourself you are perfect, that in itself is a sin. We know we can't be perfect, certainly not compared to God. But we have the grace of forgiveness, and God hears our confessions and forgives our sins. That's what we're going to do now with this prayer. Let us say it together. Let us pray. Loving Creator, following your ways isn't always an easy thing to do. Sometimes we allow our worries and doubts to cloud our visions of you and weaken our faith. Sometimes we can't feel you near us, so we try to find things that will fill the void. But those things always leave us feeling spiritually shallow or empty. Forgive us. Focus our hearts and minds on things that bring praise to your name, things that are good and right. Shine the light of your love into our lives so that we may see within ourselves the things that are a reflection of who you are. Amen. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, is ours through Jesus Christ. With faith in Christ, we rest secure. Amen. Our anthem today comes from a church group in Australia. It's part of the Hillsong Church, which has become worldwide, but began in Australia. Some of them are going to sing us their version of one of the great hymns, How Great Thou Art.
O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed, and then sings my
how great thou art,
how great thou art,
how great
questions can be tricky, depending on how they are worded. For some questions, there simply is no right or wrong answer. Imagine that someone asks you if you've stopped kicking the cat, and then they tell you they want just a straight yes or no answer. Boy, you're in trouble. If you say yes, you have stopped kicking the cat, it implies that before you were kicking the cat and now you've stopped. But what's the alternative? The only other option is no. No, I haven't stopped kicking the cat. Which suggests not only were you kicking the cat before, you still are. And that can get you into a whole lot of trouble. What you really want to say is, I've never kicked the cat. I wouldn't. But you've been told you can only give a yes or no answer. That's a trap. It's a heads I win, tails you lose situation. Questions can definitely be tricky. A good lawyer in court can twist a witness up in knots by asking carefully worded questions. And that was what people were trying to do to Jesus in today's gospel reading. And when I say people, well, it was two distinct groups. First of all, there were the Pharisees. I think they were the prime movers in this. The Pharisees, of course, were the pious folk who'd been outraged by what Jesus was teaching and by what he was claiming about himself. But this time, they took along some allies. They took with them the Herodians. Now, you might not know what a Herodian is, but basically, they were people who supported the king, King Herod the Great. So they wouldn't have been fans of anyone who was going around reportedly claiming to be king of the Jews. There was only one king, Herod the Great, and some of them even thought he was the Messiah. So they didn't want anybody else claiming to be that. So the Pharisees and the Herodians both wanted to trap Jesus, and their question about taxes was a very smart one. Was it right for the Jewish people to pay the poll tax to the hated Roman occupiers? Now, like the question about kicking the cat, both yes and no answers would get Jesus into a whole lot of trouble. If he said yes, they should pay the tax, they knew it would upset everyone in Israel who wanted to get rid of those Romans. If he said no, they shouldn't pay the tax, then the Pharisees could march straight off to the authorities and tell them that this Jesus person was encouraging revolt against the empire, telling people not to pay the taxes. But as always, Jesus is too smart for them. He knew they were trying to trap him. So he asked them to show him the coin that they used to pay these poll taxes. This is almost certainly what the coin looked like. This is a denarius with the image of the Emperor Tiberius Augustus on it. In Israel at that time, there were two kinds of coins in use. First, there were these Roman coins. And these were what most things would have been paid with, including the hated poll tax. But then there were also Jewish coins like this one. These are what were used for paying anything that was part of their Jewish faith, like paying their own Jewish temple taxes. These are their shekels. This is why there were money changers in the temple. They were there to swap the Roman coins for Jewish ones. It would defile the temple to have Roman money given. So they were there to change bad money into good. But Jesus overthrew their temples and turfed them out of the temple because they were cheating people by charging an exorbitant exchange rate. They were making money from the people's desires to bring an offering to God. Incidentally, these shekels are also what would have been given to Judas. They were his pieces of silver. But the Roman poll tax was paid with the first coin you saw. It was paid with the denarius. And Jesus pointed to the coin and asked his inquisitors, "Whose image is it on this coin?" "Caesar's," they had to say. So Jesus said, "Give to Caesar what belongs to Caesar." In other words, paying the poll tax was simply giving the Romans back something that they already owned. It was their coins, you might as well give them back to them. It wasn't as if the Jews were paying these taxes with what they thought of as their money, the shekels. Well, the Pharisees and the Herodians couldn't argue with Jesus. They couldn't answer his logic, and they slunk away to lick their wounds and hopefully not to kick the cat. But why does all this matter to us? Aren't we wasting our time by still wondering and worrying about a question of a tax from 2,000 years ago that we will never be asked to pay? So why do we care about Jesus' answer? We're never going to have to pay this poll tax. Who cares about a situation that we will never be placed in, right? Ah, but give to Caesar what is Caesar's wasn't all that Jesus said, was it? That's not his complete answer. He also said, give to God what is God's. Now, think about this. Remember, how was it that they knew that that silver coin belonged to Caesar? Because it bore his picture. His image was right there on the coin. His face is on it, in what I would say, frankly, is a rather unflattering profile. But it's still him. So give it back to him. Give to God what is God's. Now that is such an innocent looking statement. But who or what is God's? For the answer to that, you have to go all the way back to Genesis chapter 1. Then God said, "Let us make mankind in our image, in our likeness, so that they may rule over the fish in the sea and the birds in the sky, over the livestock and all the wild animals, and over all the creatures that move along the ground." So God created mankind in his image. In the image of God he created them. Male and female, he created them. You bear God's image. God's likeness is stamped into who you are. After that, who really cares about a denarius or two? We have something much more important to give to God: ourselves. And that's not easy to do on our own. Anybody can give to Caesar. It's just a matter of paying a few coins in taxes. But to give to God, the one who has stamped a heavenly image onto our very selves, that's a much bigger challenge that's only possible because of the example that we see in the life of Jesus Christ and by the encouragement of the Holy Spirit. Jesus reminds us by his answer to the question about an ancient tax and by his own life and death in full obedience to God that we are, body and soul, the people of God, created in God's likeness, living here on earth as stewards of this planet, of all that it contains. And we are ambassadors for God's kingdom. That is both worthy of celebration and it's also a huge challenge, to give to God our very selves. For we are the coins of God's kingdom. May we each remember every single day in whose likeness and for whose purposes we were created. Amen. Not many of Martin Rinkert's books have survived, which is probably because he lived in a town that was regularly being besieged by competing armies. And it's a shame that we've lost most of his work, because he was clearly very talented, as we'll see in his best known hymn, which we'll sing now. Now thank we all our God.
Thank you.
give to Caesar what is Caesar's, but give to God what is God's. At this time, I ask you to consider whether you can make an offering to Orono United Church. If you are able to, there are two ways to do it, either through our online donation button or by sending a check to our mailing address. Whichever you decide, whether you can give or not give, may God bless you in the days ahead. I'm going to lead us now in the prayers of the people as we spend some time thanking God for all that we have received and asking Him to help make us all that we can be. There will be some time in these prayers for you to spend in quietness, just remembering those close to your heart, especially those who you feel are in need of prayer at this time. Let us turn to God, knowing that God is listening. Let us pray. God of everlasting goodness, you are our creator and our guide. Be close to us and hear the prayers we bring before you now. Forgive us when we forget to trust you to provide us with every blessing in this life. Help us not to keep things for ourselves, but to share what we have with everyone in need, especially our love. Giver of all gifts, teach us to treasure Christ and His grace above all earthly possessions. Help us to practice grace and not judgment, love and not hate, giving and not receiving, praising and not being praised, trusting and not worrying. Oh God, we are so blessed to have been created in your likeness. Help us to remember that that carries a big responsibility with it. We are stewards of your creation and ambassadors for your gospel. Loving God, take our lives and let them be dedicated to you. That's the prayer we ask for ourselves. We pray that we might not be a stumbling block in the way of others finding a deeper faith in you. Now at this time, we pray for blessings upon others. We ask that you reach out through your Spirit to those known to us, those who are closest to our hearts and who are worrying us right now. We ask, O God, that you use us or others as your servants so that whatever they need most in their life, they can be shared from what we have. Hear us as we pray. We offer you, O God, our personal thanksgivings for your answers to our prayers and for all the good things you have blessed us with, even though we all too often don't appreciate enough what you have given to us. Hear our hymns of praise and listen to our whispers of grace. we pray to you through Jesus Christ. Amen. Our final hymn is another classic written by the blind American lyricist Fanny Crosby. When she wrote this song, it wasn't immediately very popular in her home country, but it really caught on in Britain and in Australia. And then in 1954, Billy Graham used it in one of his American crusades, and since then it's been sung everywhere. Let's join our voices together and sing, "To God Be the Glory." God of power and glory, may your Holy Spirit transform us with boldness. May your Holy Spirit fill us with gentleness. And may your Holy Spirit equip us for the tasks that you are setting for us. As we go now in your name. Amen.
Now in peace. shall rise to thee, O Lord.